Good afternoon. To those of you on the East Coast and the Central Time Zones, good morning to those of you on the West Coast and in the Mountain Time Zone. I am Phyllis Silver. I'm the Executive Director of the Partnership for Quality Care, known as PQC. And just hold on 1 second. Who is advancing the slides? Thank you. Okay, so it's my privilege to welcome you. This is the fourth webinar in our series as we address the importance of improving antibiotic use and, in fact, the impact that that can have on the health of our nation. Our last webinar focused on bringing antibiotic stewardship into outpatient practices, and specifically we discussed managing patient expectations. We know that programs on antibiotic stewardship improve patient outcomes, and the need to improve antibiotic use has never been greater, particularly as we are encountering bacteria that are increasingly resistant to our antibiotics. And to that end, today's webinar is the first in a series of webinars that we're planning that will address the role of the environmental healthcare workforce and their role in saving lives, specifically the fact that the workforce needs practical strategies to stay ahead of this challenging situation. From the beginning of this work on antibiotic stewardship, our partners at CDC have emphasized to us that the environmental services efforts that we're embarking on has the very significant potential to lead to real change in the practice of removing resistant bacteria. And CDC has always stressed the importance to us of the role of the environmental services workforce. Today's webinar responds to our PQC members who've expressed a real interest to have access to the most current and accurate information available regarding disinfection best practices. It's our hope that today we'll initiate a series of webinars that will engage the environmental services teams in our hospitals and community settings. Before we begin, let me tell you a few things about the Partnership for Quality Care. We are a national labor management coalition, fortunate to claim as members some of the nation's leading health systems, more than 1 million SEIU healthcare workers, and together our members care for more than 50 million patients each year. PQC came together almost 10 years ago to assist in the effort that resulted in the passage of the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act. And since then, our work has focused primarily on areas of quality improvement and transformation of the healthcare workforce. Today, our unprecedented labor management partnership is especially appreciative to be collaborating with the Centers for Disease Control on this issue of such importance. I want to thank all of you today who are joining our webinar. We will keep you on our mail list to inform you of our upcoming PQC activities. And just a few words of housekeeping before I turn over the mic. You will note that only the speakers have mics at this point in time. Everyone else is muted. You are invited to write questions in the chat room on the lower left-hand corner of your screen so that after today's faculty, Dr. Deverick Anderson, completes his presentation, Dr. Kavita Trivedi, who is leading some of this PQC CDC effort, will pull your questions from the chat room and will start a conversation for our question and answer session. You will receive the slide deck shortly after today's session, and in addition, you'll be able to find a recording of today's webinar on the PQC website later today, and that'll be pqc-usa.org. That link will be posted just after the Q&A session. So now it's my distinct pleasure and honor to once again be able to turn the microphone over to our CDC partner and national leader, Dr. Arjun Srinivasan. Dr. Arjun Srinivasan is the Associate Director of the Healthcare Associated Infection Prevention Programs at CDC in the Division of Healthcare Quality Promotion. He is a captain in the public health service. He is a true visionary, and he has a deep passion and has been a wonderful collaborator for us in terms of beginning to make a difference. Arjun?
Thanks so much, Phyllis. And again, appreciation for all that the Partnership for Quality Care is doing in this area to really help us address this problem of antibiotic resistance. As Phyllis mentioned, this is really one of the most pressing and serious threats to all of our patients, and is going to require a tremendous activity from a host of different stakeholders. And one of the most important groups that we need our help from are our environmental services colleagues. And so I really think that the Partnership for Quality Care is so uniquely positioned to engage our colleagues in environmental services so that we can have a two-way dialogue to better understand what you all need in order to do your critical jobs most effectively. And to that end, I'm pleased to be able to introduce Dev today, because one of the things that people have talked about is the need for the latest information. What is new with respect to environmental cleaning? What's really innovative and cutting edge? And there is probably no better person in the country to give that presentation than Deverick Anderson. Dev's an associate professor in the Division of Infectious Diseases and Department of Medicine at Duke University, and is currently the director of the Duke Center for Antimicrobial Stewardship and Infection Prevention. Over the past decade, Dev's work has led to improvements in the quality and safety of care in multiple areas of healthcare, including large tertiary care hospitals, but also smaller community hospitals. Dev's authored more than 140 peer-reviewed articles related to quality of care, patient safety, healthcare epidemiology, antimicrobial stewardship, and multi-drug-resistant pathogens, and he's received research funding from the NIH, the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, and from us at CDC. And he's actually currently the principal investigator of the Duke UNC Prevention Epicenters Program for CDC. He's a member of the Board of Trustees for the Society of Healthcare Epidemiology of America, and is an alumnus of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation's Physician Faculty Scholars Program, and a member of the steering committee for the NIH's Antibacterial Resistance Leadership Group. And most germane to the discussion today, Dev has most recently led a very large, really multi-center national study on environmental disinfection. So like I said, he is so perfectly positioned to give us this talk today and help us understand where the evidence is with respect to some innovations in the cleaning of the healthcare environment. And with that, let me turn it over to Dev. Dev?
Thank you, Arjun. Thanks, everyone. It's my pleasure to be with you today. And it looks to me, just for people helping with the slides in the background, that I will have to ask you to do the next slide kind of routine, but I can see the webinar slides in front of me, so I think we'll be good to go. So next slide, we'll start with just my disclosures. They were reviewed very well by Arjun. There's not anything else to add there. And then really, I think, just jump into our discussion for today. And what I want to go through with you is really a little bit of background information about why this topic is becoming so increasingly important to us. And then, but spend most of our time focusing on one particular strategy to improve our efforts against environmental contamination and its impact on patient care and safety, and the use of UV-emitting devices. And I'll go into that in more detail based on that trial that Arjun was referencing. So when we start this conversation, I think I want to prove a few points to you as to why this is an issue that we really should be concerned about. And point number one is that the hospital environment is contaminated, full stop. There's plenty of data out there that whichever kind of resistant bug you're looking at, VRE, C. difficile, Acinetobacter, or MRSA, you can find it in hospitals. And in particular, if a patient has had one of these infections, you can very easily find it in that patient's hospital room. As you see from the table on the right, in all areas of the room as well, from sink to laundry bins and medical carts and even floors and so forth and so on. The hospital environment is contaminated. So next slide. And unfortunately, the environment, this contaminated environment is often in adequately cleaned. This slide provides some data from a study done by Phil Carling looking at several, 30 to 40 to 50 hospitals that were participating and trying to measure how well rooms were cleaned. And so what you see here in green is the daily clean of, come in from one day to the next. It becomes so infrequently in that environment that you would clean it that it's come to be called trash and dash. An environmental housekeeper will come in, basically grab the trash, and then move on to the next room. There's not really much cleaning that goes on, as you can see here. Then the other area is terminal clean, and this is an important term for us to define because it's what we'll focus on for the rest of our discussion today. And this is the idea of cleaning the room in between patients. And the analogy we use is one where if you think of the last time you were in a hotel, you were there for maybe 2 or 3 days, and from one day to the next, you get your bed maybe gets made, maybe they take the trash out, but there's not a whole lot more cleaning that goes on. But you certainly hope that the room was cleaned very thoroughly before you got there, and hopefully then gets cleaned thoroughly for that next person as well. Those are terminal cleans. And unfortunately, at least historically, we don't do a very good job of hitting appropriate surfaces in our hospital rooms at the terminal clean either. Next slide. So if it's contaminated and we're not cleaning it, well, what does that mean for our patients? And what that means is I'll show you on these next couple of slides is that puts our patients at risk. And so a few studies that are summarized here looking at risk for the very next patient in the room. These are all kind of case control and cohort epidemiologically based studies. Flip to the next slide, please. And the reason that this risk exists is if it's contaminated, we don't clean it, then it can stay there long enough for that next patient to be exposed. Because if you look at MRSA, VRE, Acinetobacter, these are what we call vegetative bacteria. They can stay several days to a week. And C. difficile as a spore-forming organism can, of course, stay essentially forever. And so if you move to the next slide, this sets up this model that we have to hopefully address, and that we know contaminated, the environment is contaminated, and that environment leads to risk. And then we would like to think that our interventions that decrease environmental contamination then decrease the risk for those next patients in the room. And it's this kind of model, I think, that really is where that leads to this emphasis on improving the way that we clean these rooms and removing as many of these bad pathogens as we can. So next slide. To focus then on UV disinfection, I want to start with a few slides of background, kind of how we got to the starting point of our study. And then I'll give you some details about our study. We called it the Benefits of Enhanced Terminal Room Disinfection, or the BETR Disinfection Study. And I'll give you some details there about how we arrived at those details. We'll talk about some limitations, and I think probably just as importantly, we'll discuss some of the lessons that we learned in completing that study. So next slide, please. And we'll move past that one as well. So just the overview, why does UV light work? How does it kill bacteria? And the way that it kills them is through direct damage to the nucleic acid of these bacteria. And it is highly effective. If you have UV that is irradiates these small microbes, then you will kill those microbes a very large proportion of the time. And one of the really interesting things about this technology is that not only can you kill bacteria that are in the direct line of sight, you can imagine your light that's in your room and then the top of your desk, that's a direct line from the light to that surface, but you also have reflective properties of UV that can still help us kill more bacteria. And so the underside of that desk that's in shadow is actually still being irradiated by UV, and if there are bacteria, when you have one of these devices, you can kill bacteria even in shadowed areas. Another nice thing about this area is that there are quite a few companies that are getting into making these machines, and hopefully that means that eventually that's going to help drive down some of the prices for these. So next slide. For the next couple of slides that I'll show you, again, I want to kind of help lead you to kind of how the science grew. And so some of the first studies were done by our colleagues over at UNC, Bill Rutella and David Weber, where they experimentally inoculated surfaces in a hospital, a kind of an experimental hospital room, and then used these machines. And we're focusing again on what we'll call the big four, these four organisms that you've seen before in these slides, you'll see again that are listed here. And, you know, with these kind of experimental conditions, you know how much you're putting down, you expose them to this UV light, and then you can calculate how much is still remains there. You can see that there was, you know, for direct line of sight, more than 4 log reduction. That's, you know, 99.99% reduction. And for indirect in shadow, again, not as effective, but still quite effective in that you're getting almost 3 log kill, that again, that 99.9%, and then a little bit less for C. difficile, especially in shadow, and even a difference that you see there. So we know that it works in experimental conditions. So next slide, what about in the real world? And so then you look at measuring these contaminated environments in a hospital room using these UV machines to then irradiate the room in the absence of any chemical disinfectant. So this is really just seeing what happens with the UV light and seeing, as you see before and after here, the numbers go from, you know, usually pretty high to usually pretty low as far as the amount of bacteria that could be captured after using one of these machines. So again, experimental conditions, now to kind of this more real world setting, it seems to work. Now what I'm showing you here is MRSA. If you flip to the next slide, you essentially get the same kind of idea with the other organisms that we like to focus on. So significant reduction in VRE, C. diff, and we performed this experiment and we just didn't have enough Acinetobacter to come up with a statistical difference, but clearly the actual decrease in the proportions was pretty dramatic even for Acinetobacter. So next slide. If you're looking for more proof, one of the debates that comes up in this field is there are basically two flavors of UV. And the one that we used in our study is UVC. And most companies, that's the type of UV they use. There's another type where they use a xenon bulb. And it's slightly different in its physics, but this slide is included to demonstrate that it actually is very effective as well when it comes to reducing the amount of bacteria that can be found even in the real world environment. So one question that inevitably comes up, next slide, is are there any differences between these machines that are out there? And the real answer is in general, no. They all demonstrate some reduction in bacteria, and there are really only limited head-to-head information about which ones might be better. There has only been one published study where they compared this pulsed xenon approach versus the UVC. And in that study done by Kurt Donsky and his group, they actually showed that the UVC had a higher amount of reduction than the pulsed xenon did when all other factors were controlled. So there is likely some superiority or some additional benefit from the UVC compared to the pulsed xenon when put head to head. Now, as far as the different UV machines that are out there, there have been two studies that compared those. This is a sample figure from one of those, and it basically demonstrates that there's not really a whole lot of difference in the effectiveness of the different UVC machines. Next slide. So what I've showed you now is experimental conditions, hospital environment. What about patient outcomes? In the end, that's really what we're trying to focus on here. And in the years before our study, there was some growing evidence that when these machines were used in individual hospitals, that they seemed to lead to a decrease in infections for patients. Now, there were always some issues with the study in that they're what we would call a quasi-experimental study design. That means, you know, again, in every instance, a single hospital had perhaps an issue, they started to use one of these machines, oftentimes with other interventions as well. And, you know, as an example slide, you see this figure, and then their rates would go down. And one of the most recent ones that was published was out of the University of Pennsylvania, where they looked at C. difficile rates and showed a 50% reduction in their high-risk hem-onc wards. And so good, right? These are good studies. They help us kind of get the idea that there may be something here, but they still are not necessarily studies that drive what we might consider as best practices because they don't have good controls, and it's hard to generalize to broader applications. So this then leads us to the next slide, and our randomized controlled trial that, again, we call the BETR Disinfection Study. So if you move to the next slide, we designed this study really to determine if this enhanced strategy for disinfection really decreased acquisition and infection of these four targeted MDROs. So again, the focus was on the patient outcomes. That's really what we wanted to look into with this. And the way we did our best to try and answer that question was design this as a prospective multicenter cluster randomized crossover trial that involved nine hospitals. And basically, as I think we'll get into in a little more detail shortly, compared four different approaches to terminal disinfection. And these were done in 7-month intervals, and it was the order of those different regimens that was randomized for each individual hospital. That's where this randomized at the level of the hospital. Next slide. This is a map that shows the nine hospitals that participated. I think the point to make here is that we had a pretty good representation of different types of hospital in this particular study. Two tertiary care centers with Duke and UNC. We had the Durham VA, and then six community hospitals that participated in a network that we call the Duke Infection Control Outreach Network. So these were hospitals that we had partnered with for several years, kind of in anticipation of this study. Next slide. So just to give you some details, these next two or three slides do get into the weeds a little bit, just to warn you. But inevitably, these kinds of slides are, you know, hopefully can help with those inevitable questions that come up about how we ultimately did things. So again, 28 months, every hospital used all four cleaning strategies, and the four are depicted in this red, blue, yellow, and green figure that you see on the bottom right there. And so our reference was just the use of quaternary ammonium, and that was, you know, phase A, as you see. No UV machines were used at terminal disinfection. Phase B was adding UVC to the kind of standard disinfectant approach. C was the use of bleach, and then D was the use of bleach and UV light. And these were targeted to contact precaution rooms. So these were not strategies that we used in every single room in these hospitals. Ultimately ends up being probably 20% of rooms or so. But as you see, you know, each hospital would go through every strategy for 7-month blocks, and you see these black bars at the bottom. Those were depicting this wash-in period where we made sure that when we were starting these strategies, there was sufficient time for the environmental services groups really to get up to speed with the use of these protocols. So during that time, we were getting things going up to speed, but not calculating or using any of the outcomes that happened. Next slide. And again, some more of those details, but these are important ones. So again, how we really we're looking at patients, or what's depicted on this slide. So we defined a seed room as any room in which a patient had documented infection or colonization with one of our target MDROs. Depending on where they were in the study, the hospital would then perform one of the terminal cleans by our protocol. And then the next patient in that room is what we would call an exposed patient. And that exposed patient had to be in the room for at least 24 hours to qualify. They would then move from being an exposed patient to a potential incident case, potentially one of our outcomes, if they ended up having a positive culture for the same organism as the patient that was in the seed room. So again, if the seed room was because a patient had MRSA, our exposed patient would have to have MRSA to count as one of our outcomes. And so you see you could have one of these cultures for up to 90 days for these vegetative bacteria and up to 28 days for C. difficile. And then we used exposure days as the time spent in the seed room as a way to try and, you know, account for the amount of risk that a patient might have. Next slide. But even if you met all those criteria, you could still be excluded if it was not clear that the outcome was related to the patient before you. And the way we would then eliminate some people, if you had had MRSA before in that example I just gave you, you wouldn't qualify because we couldn't say whether or not that MRSA culture was from you because you already had it or from being in that room. And then if you just happen to come into a room but you came in with your MRSA abscess from the community, then we excluded those as well. The next slide. So ultimately, this study included upwards of 315,000 patients and many, many room stays. If you see, you know, again, we won't get into the details here, but if you move from this big, big cohort of people into those who meet all of these study criteria, you got to be in a contact precaution room. That cuts you down to 20%, and then you got to be able to, you know, exclude some. Then ultimately, we had approximately 20,000 patients that we included in our analysis, and that's what we call this intention to treat analysis. So again, we can certainly go into more details there. I think for our focus today, we're going to keep moving along so we can get to some of the results. So if you go to the next slide, this is the first slide with results. This is our primary outcome, and that is looking at the rates of all four of these MDROs together. So a cumulative outcome for all four of these. And so the big rectangle is pointing first your attention to the reference group. And so there are 115 of these outcomes and 22,000 of these exposure days. And then you go from that study phase A to the B, C, and D, what we consider as our intervention arms. And there are a few things to point out. First off is that all three of the study intervention arms had a decrease in the rate of outcome, so between 30% and 9 or 10% if you go from B to C to D. But only one of them, study phase B, actually had a decrease, a statistically significant decrease. And so that is further depicted in the figure that you see on the right side. We concluded as a result of this that by adding UV light to our standard chemical disinfectant approach, that we could in fact reduce the risk of MDRO acquisition and infection. So we'll now get into a few slides with organism-specific results. So the next slide, please. Look at C. difficile. And this is where some of the methods get to be a little bit confusing and difficult, but in a nutshell, every single time we had a C. diff room, it was always cleaned with bleach. Didn't matter which arm you were in. So we, as a result, really only have one comparison when it comes to looking at C. diff, and that's to look at bleach versus bleach and UV. And as you see here, adding UV to bleach did not impact the rate of C. difficile outcomes. Next slide. If you go to our vegetative bacteria, however, you'll see that, as shown here, MRSA, there was some impact in study phase B, though it didn't meet our criteria for statistical significance. I think if you keep that number in mind and then move to the next slide, you see that there was kind of the same idea. There was a decrease in study phase B, but not statistically significant. My sense is that it's really the combination of MRSA and BRE together that finally pushed us over the threshold for significance in study phase B. An interesting thing, however, that we observed here is that both of the bleach arms led to decreases in the rate of VRE outcomes, with the lowest rate occurring in the bleach and UV arm. So again, what I've been showing you so far is focusing specifically on that very next patient in the room. So we then asked the question, well, if you're doing this in these kind of targeted areas, what does that really do to the full patient population in this hospital? So if you move to the next slide, this gives you some idea about some of those numbers. So again, much larger numbers. We did see a 11% decrease in all target MDROs. That's our overall outcome, and it remains statistically significant. And actually, we did have an impact on C. difficile when you broaden the scope to the hospital level, though our number was smaller than previously published estimates. And we suspect part of that is because of some biases that are introduced in some of the quasi-experimental approaches. That's just an idea. This is an area that we're actually in the process of trying to flesh out and try and understand where this C. difficile outcome comes from, since it may not have been directly related to the next patient in the room. Was there some second order benefits? We're trying to figure that out. So we'll have to update you on that perhaps at some future call. Okay, so the next couple of slides really get into some of the data we collected on how we were doing with the protocols. This was important for us to measure because we wanted to be able to say with certainty that the only real change that was happening between these different study arms was the use of the chemical, the use of the disinfection protocol. We did not want to have one arm where hand hygiene was 100% and then the next arm was 0%. And then have the difficulty of really, you know, saying, well, are the changes related to this change in hand hygiene or our chemical or disinfectant or UV? And so luckily, there were no major differences in study arms when we looked at hand hygiene rates, the number of surfaces being cleaned, and colonization pressure, which is really a measure for how many people are coming into a hospital with these drug-resistant bugs. The idea there is that the more people that come in, and the higher your colonization pressure, then the higher risk for subsequent transmission. Compliance with protocols was high, so they really did a good job of getting the machines where we needed them to be. They did a good job of using the right chemicals as we measured in our study. So next slide. We ultimately had almost 22,000 uses of these UV devices. And one of the really strong, important things we figured out is that if you can get the machine in the room and turn it on, then almost every time you have sufficient amount of time to finish the cycle. You see, we completed the cycle 97% of the time. There are two different ways you use these, at least the machine we were using. There's a vegetative cycle, which is typically shorter, and a spore cycle. You can see then over on the right side how that impacted the time that it takes to use these machines. In general, it's about 30 minutes, but that number gets higher when you start using this as a spore cycle for C. difficile. It gets a little closer to an hour. So that obviously has some major implications, and that's where I think we'll turn our attention now to the next slide, where we'll go through some lessons learned through this study. So next slide. So one of the things we learned very quickly, I imagine many of you on this call already know this lesson, but it was made all too clear to us, is that there is already existing tension between environmental services and bed control. And, you know, bed control is interested in filling beds as quickly as possible. EBS is caught up in that pressure, yet is still charged with doing a good job of cleaning the rooms. And we found that this tension existed in all 9 study hospitals, perhaps some worse than others, but it existed. And again, the idea was how quickly can we turn this thing over? So as an example, as part of this study, we polled EVS folks, we polled nurse managers that were in touch with bed control, and we got some interesting results as far as the kind of outward perceptions of these different groups. So environmental services, when they were asked a question, you know, if there are delays in filling beds, what's the typical reason for the delay? EVS said that almost always it would be because of the emergency room. The nurses and bed control folks said that almost always it's because of delays in cleaning related to environmental service. So there was already kind of, you know, up against a challenge in these preconceived perceptions about where there were issues. Now, what we did to overcome this is really work very hard on establishing regular and specific communication between bed control, environmental services. We typically would have infection control in those conversations as well, at least every once in a while, and then often some of the nurse managers. But really putting bed control and EVS together was critical. Here's an example. If you've got, you know, ward 800 in this meeting, you know, it happens in the morning, one of the first things they say, well, we're expecting about 5 discharges. Well, environmental services can say, well, you know, this room and this room. So 2 of our 5 are going to need this TrueD machine. And so that immediately means that the beds 1, 2, and 3 get filled before beds 4 and 5. But if that hadn't been discussed and figured out ahead of time, then inevitably the first patient that's coming to the unit gets assigned to bed 5, which is then delayed because it's on, you know, getting this TrueD machine, this UV machine. So this was a really critical component. It's hard to oversell this issue. It really was an important one for us. The next lesson that we learned was that we needed to develop redundant systems to make sure we were effectively identifying our targeted rooms. What we learned was that no system we found was perfect. whether it's the signs on the doors or infection control rounds or, you know, these electronic lists of people on contact precautions or even, you know, these establishing this communication. None of these were perfect. But if we, our goal and our theory was that if we can kind of use all of these, then it's essentially like you're putting four slices of Swiss cheese on top of each other, and hopefully when you do that, there are only a few holes left, if any at all. And so when we developed our systems, we felt very strongly that there had to be some redundancy to try and overcome the idea that none of them were perfect. The next lesson we learned is that you really have to do some planning for peak utilization, when these rooms turn over, and in particular when the UV machine might be required. And so these are data, again, directly from our study. We had data from documented on almost 600,000 room turnovers and basically broke them up first by shift. So shift, you know, 1, 2, and 3. Shift 1, I believe, is like 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., you know, 3 to 11, and then 11 to 7. Those are the shifts 1, 2, and 3, and then by hour as well. And so, as you might guess, most of the room turnovers happen in shifts 1 and 2, but if you look more closely at the hour distribution, unfortunately, it's usually right at that transition. So right at about, you know, 1,500 hours there, 14, 15, 16 is when EVS shifts transition. And so you have to be prepared for, you know, the possibility that if there's a machine, a room that needs the machine and there's this handoff that happens, then that puts in play the idea that it could be forgotten or, you know, miscommunicated or just not happen. And so this allowed us to work more with the environmental services groups to try and develop strategies to make sure that these peak times were well accounted for. Next slide, please. The other thing to keep in mind is that when you use these enhanced strategies for disinfection, is you will increase the amount of time that is required to turn over these rooms. And so this has to be really an explicit conversation with bed control. The emphasis is on safety, but it is worth it because we think that these enhanced strategies have value in improving safety. And so if you look total time and then there is room cleaning time, well, one of the ways we broke this up, so total time is really you've got a room that is, you know, the patient is discharged from and it's declared dirty to the room is declared clean and it's ready for the next patient to come in. That's total time. What we learned is that there's really two parts of that. One is that the room has a cold time where there's nothing happening with the room. And then once EVS finally gets there, there's the room cleaning time. And so you see total time in general, the amount of time required for room turnover was between 80 and 90 minutes. However, only, you know, 35 to 40 minutes of that was actual room cleaning time. And so that's important, and one of the things that we would then focus on is that if you are able to develop strategies to get the environmental services groups to the room more quickly, then you can overcome some of the additional, although just a handful, just a few minutes of extra time that's not going to be required on average when you use one of these kinds of machines. Next slide. One of the other things then we did is we think is very important is that you have to have some ability to provide feedback to environmental services and housekeepers about how well they are cleaning the surfaces. And the way we did that was using these fluorescent markers. You put them in the room before the housekeeper gets there. You come back after the housekeeper has cleaned the room and see how many of them have been wiped away. And then you can calculate a pretty simple proportion. Now, one of the things we had an idea about during the study was that it probably mattered who was doing the measurement. And so if the EVS supervisor was monitoring how well rooms were cleaned, putting these fluorescent dots down and then calculating afterwards, inevitably those numbers and the performance was higher than if we had kind of a blinded or, you know, quote-unquote disinterested party calculating those numbers. This is human nature is one. We see this all over the place. And, you know, for example, in hand hygiene, right? But I think it speaks to the idea that, one, you need to have some way to monitor these, but two, you need to know that none of these is necessarily going to be perfect, and you have to kind of keep on this issue and develop strategies to rotate locations and things like that so that it's a little bit less of a known fact that they're being monitored. One of the things we also observed that I think likely led to these higher numbers is if EVS supervisors saw that a room was not well cleaned, they would actually have the housekeeper come back and clean it again. And then what they would input into the system was the post-second clean numbers. And so that likely led to some increase in difference between our numbers and theirs as well. Okay, just a few more slides to go, and then certainly I'm interested in whatever questions are there. One of the things to keep in mind when using a machine like a UV emitting device is that the size of the room, or more appropriately said, the volume of the room really matters. And so the big ICU rooms take more time than the small single bed acute care non-ICU rooms. And so this actually manifested itself in kind of the individual study hospitals' rates or amount of time required. So you can see big difference between hospital 3 and hospital 5. And in hospital 5, really small rooms, basically just a big rectangle. It only took about 25 minutes on average. Hospital 3 had much larger rooms, especially ICU rooms, and had a really difficult room configuration in that their bathroom doors essentially pointed away from the rest of the room. And so in order for us to get the machine in a location where it would both shine into the bathroom and into the rest of the room, it was in a very inefficient location in the corner, and that manifested itself in longer times as well. So I can quote for you 30 minutes and 50 minutes, but there is variation from hospital to hospital. So that's, I think, very important to keep in mind. Now, the next couple of slides, perhaps the last lesson learned, is we felt very strongly that putting in place competition is a good way to improve compliance with protocols. And so we had the hospitals that were participating compete against one against another for how, you know, many times they could use the machine, what their compliance rates were with the chemicals and with the UV machines. Our goal was to get up to 90%, and our average after the study was 89%, so we got really, really close. And I think putting in place competitions for, you know, donut parties or pizza parties and things like that was a part of our strategy to really boost compliance. So next slide. Now, perhaps this is the last lesson, is that bad stuff can and does happen. And that of the 21,000 uses of the machine, we did have one safety event where a nurse went into a room where the UV machine was shining and then had sunspots afterwards as a result. She was trying to get in and see and how to turn it off because she couldn't find the remote from the outside of the room, and then couldn't find how to turn it off while she was in there. And so she was in there probably 5 seconds or so and had, you know, had those sunspots that you see if you look at the sun or really bright lights in your vision. It was temporary, went away, no long-lasting effects, but this did lead to us having to kind of refine and reemphasize our safety protocols as part of this study. Okay, so last couple of slides here. To summarize our study for you, you know, the bottom line is we think because of our study that the use of these UV machines can be considered an evidence-based strategy. That is, in a randomized controlled trial, we were able to demonstrate that the use of the addition of these machines to standard chemical approach decreased the risk of MDROs by 30%. You can quibble about the other arms, and again, maybe that's a different discussion to have. But overall, all of the arms did decrease our outcomes, but the one that had the biggest decrease was adding UV to that standard chemical cleaning. It seemed that the biggest impact was on the MRSA and BRE. I haven't mentioned it, but I didn't show you acinetobacter results because we only had one in the entire study. Not really much to say there, and certainly didn't impact much on the rest of our results. I think the issue was the use of these machines or just enhanced cleaning in general and its impact on C. diff is one that remains up in the air. I am not certain if this is going to be our best strategy for impacting C. diff. Certainly our data suggests that maybe it wouldn't be. One of the things that happened in our study is that we cleaned the surfaces with 90% of the surfaces with bleach. And so if you do that, Maybe you don't need a UV machine. The issue is that most groups don't do that, so it's not entirely clear in my mind. But if C. diff is your main point of emphasis, there are probably some other things like stewardship that would be a better place to start. Now, even though it was a really big study, there were ultimately a few reasons why we had lower power than we expected, and that could have impacted some of our results as well. Okay, next slide. So the pros and the cons that will lead to our question session here. Again, pros of UV light, they're effective. They kill bacteria. I think you've got several individual hospital examples and now a randomized controlled trial, so we can call this an evidence-based intervention. They're pretty easy to use, automated, and don't require a lot of extensive training. And they're mobile, so you can move from one room to the next and clean quite a few rooms just with one machine. Most of our hospitals were big enough that they had more than one machine to participate in this study. And let me come back to that last bullet because it's an interesting point, I think. The cons is that, you know, any kind of enhanced strategy like this comes with costs, and these units are certainly no exception to that. I think the impact on C. diff remains up in the air. You're going to have inevitable tension between environmental services and bed control because you're adding time to the room turnover time. And there's a lot of work that has to go into the logistics as an example. So this is a limited component of environmental disinfection. This is only terminal clean. You can't use these machines for daily clean. So it's going to be limited in the impact that we can have with it. Now, these last two bullets on both sides kind of really get to this paradox we have with these kinds of approaches. And we know that UV, hydrogen peroxide, whatever it is, works better if you have done a good job of cleaning beforehand. The idea there is that if you have something like sputum or snot or whatever, you're not going to be able to penetrate that stuff with UV, and whatever's underneath it will still be there. So you need to wipe that down before you use UV. But the real reason we think that these are going to important for us is because we don't clean things effectively. And so it's an issue that I think we'll continue to struggle with. In our study, despite that potential issue, there still seem to be benefit. So with that, I'll stop, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Dev. this is Kavita Trivedi. I want to thank all of you for joining, and thank Dev for giving us that excellent presentation. We have a few minutes for questions, so if folks want to type in any questions in the chat box, we can moderate and facilitate having those answered. I am going to start while we're waiting for some questions. Dev, can you tell us a little bit about what the hospitals that participated in your study are doing now in terms of cleaning? Basically, I guess the question is, were they sold on the findings, and have they all switched to, you know, ammonia plus UV?
Yes. So good question. We get asked pretty regularly because I think it is an important point to make. All 9 study hospitals now use these UV machines, and so they were ultimately, I think, convinced through their participation in the study and then our ultimate results that these were, you know, usable, they were doable, and then actually improved patient outcomes.
Great. And was there any discussion with the C-suite at these hospitals to try to convince them that even though the turnaround time would be longer, that you know, obviously patient safety is improved. Did any of the hospitals have to have those discussions, or was it pretty straightforward in terms of getting them to switch over?
No, we were proactive in our kind of attempt to canvas the what we consider to be kind of the key groups in each of the participating hospitals. So basically, our strategy was that at the beginning of each kind of 7-month block, we would do, you know, kind of the tour amongst the study hospitals and specifically meet with C-suite, bed control, environmental services, infection control groups, and kind of try our best to get everybody on board with what was going to be occurring during those 7 months. Those conversations went relatively well, but certainly, you know, we're not necessarily just great at every place that we went. And so an example I'll give you, because this is one of those things that it's, you just kind of shake your head a little bit. So we had data from one of our hospitals. This was in the middle of the study or so. And we said, you know, here's your room turnover time. You've been participating in the study. Your room turnover time really hasn't changed at all. So, you know, this is not, we're happy to say that this has not had a major impact on your average room turnover time. And, you know, the head bed control person said, well, that may be. And again, we're talking about like 20,000 data points we're showing them. But there was that one time where we just couldn't get anybody to come by and take out the machine. And so that led to a delay on that one patient. So you're thinking, my gosh, you know, one out of 20,000, that's pretty good. And yet it was the main point of contention that the, because it just wasn't perfect, that that led to fodder for the remaining ongoing, you know, feeling of being disgruntled between environmental services and bed control. So, again, that's a long-winded way of answering your question. We were proactive, and I think anybody who's going to try and use these machines should do the same. If you're really going to be effective in deploying them, you have to have bed control on board, or you're just going to run into roadblocks.
Right. So along the same lines, one of our participants is asking, are the UVC machines that are being used now in all of the participating hospitals, are they being used in all terminal cleans or only in the ones, you know, with contact precautions or the isolation rooms?
Yes, it remains the case that all of the hospitals are still only using them in contact precaution rooms.
Okay.
And so still hasn't expanded to broader use than that. Occasionally, someone will just have a whim that they want to use it in a certain room, and oftentimes that can be accommodated. But as far as the routine approach, it remains focused on contact precautions.
Okay. And given your findings, did you have any hospitals that talked about using bleach kind of everywhere, given your findings, not just with C. diff, but on the other bacteria as well?
We didn't, and in all honesty, I was surprised by the kind of a lack of findings in the bleach side of things. But no, I think most hospitals were happy, maybe even perhaps potentially to have some excuse not to use bleach, you know, as a routine chemical disinfectant. And again, I may take that opportunity to reemphasize that throughout the study, if there was a known C. diff room, we did use bleach in those rooms. And so we're not saying that our results say use quats in absolutely every single room and just put a UV machine behind it. We can't say that with our study. We can only say quats for all rooms except C. diff, in which you use bleach. And then amongst that approach, if it's contact precautions, use UV.
Great. So another question we have from one of our participants. Oh, good. So we're getting some more questions. I don't have to keep asking you my questions. Another alternative to UV is bioquelling rooms. Do you have any information regarding the pros and cons of UV versus bioquelling?
I think by bioquelling, they're talking about using vaporized hydrogen peroxide. And
I think so, yeah.
Vaporized hydrogen peroxide, there is a randomized trial from a single center. They did it at Hopkins from a few years ago, so it has some good evidence. It is a FDA-registered sterilant, so it's highly effective. The issue with it is that it is much more logistically challenging. If you put them head-to-head and you're allowed to use them, you know, as they're supposed to be used, then the BioQuell or the vaporized hydrogen peroxide will beat the UV light. But the issues with that approach is that it can take upwards of 3 to 4 hours. There's more training that's involved. You have to kind of seal off the ducts and doors and things like that. So its biggest issue is really a logistical one. And since we struggled at times, it felt like, to get 30 extra minutes, we couldn't imagine having the argument to try and get 3 extra hours for these room turnovers.
Great. And then another question, maybe our last one, is the concern with using UV on damaging surfaces exposed to the light. So was there any change noted in room surfaces or equipment or discoloration of plastic coverings that you noted during the study?
So a couple of things to mention with that question, which is a good one. One that we get because it's something that people are concerned about. what we knew from our background work is that this type of UV is a kind of what you might call a shallow UV, and that's why actually one of its safety issues is that it does not cause skin cancer. It just doesn't penetrate deeply enough to get into skin cells and cause skin damage. And again, that's UVC, right? You think of UVA and B as far as, you know, sun damage and sunburns and so forth. But that actually has implications in how it impacts plastics as well, because thick plastics, it doesn't really impact. Thin, and the example that we were given was, you think of your grocery store bag. If the grocery store bag were exposed to this UVC light for a long period of time, it would eventually degrade it. So with that background, we did some more subjective analysis of how the use of these machines impacted equipment. And so we got kind of like operations directors and the environmental services supervisors and nurse managers. We got them to give us their feedback on whether or not these machines were causing any problems or plastics or surfaces. And across the board, the answer was no. There was no perception that they were causing any trouble.
Great. Okay, one last question. I wanted to bring up cost. How much approximately do the UVC machines cost? And somebody says this is the first question my CEO is going to ask me.
Yeah, of course. And the answer is it depends, because it depends on which product you're talking about. The range in general is somewhere between $40,000 and probably $80,000 per unit. So they have significant costs.
Okay. And have there been any studies done showing how it actually, you know, impacts cost savings once these machines are being used? Did you guys look at that?
We haven't yet. So we haven't done our formal cost effectiveness analysis. It's on the list of things we want to do. But we have not yet gone down that pathway yet. Just for back of the envelope kind of calculations, we do believe that if you start talking about, you know, preventing 2 to 3 of these outcomes each year, then you're paying for the machine, you know, because they're just so expensive when the MRSA and C. diff BRE infections happen. So we don't have the formal analysis. Our sense is that it's going to be pretty close, if not cost-effective, based on those back-of-the-envelope kind of calculations.
Great. Well, we have a couple more questions, and I think what we'll do probably, Dev, if okay with you, we'll probably connect you to the person who's asking the question and send you a couple more questions over email later in the day today. But I really want to thank you so much for doing this presentation. It was excellent, and we are positive that our listeners and the people that will listen to the recording in the future will really appreciate this presentation. So thank you so much for your time, and I want to thank you all for listening, and then we'll close. Thanks so much.